Hachette Audio presents Troy, The Greek Myths, Reimagined, Volume 3 of Mythos. Written by Stephen Fry. Read by Stephen Fry.
Introductory note. The birth and rise of gods and humans is the subject of my book Mythos, whose successor, Heroes, covers the great feats, quests, and adventures of mortal heroes such as Hercules, Theseus, Jason, and Perseus. You do not have to know those books to enjoy this one, and no pre-existing knowledge of the mythological world is presumed or required for you to embark on Troy. As I remind you from time to time, especially early on in the book, do not think for a minute that you have to remember all those names, places, and familial interrelationships. To give background, I do describe the founding of many different dynasties and kingdoms, but I assure you that when it comes to the main action, the different threads do turn from a tangle into a tapestry. A two-part appendix at the end addresses the issue of how much of what follows is history and how much myth. It fell from heaven. Troy, the most marvelous kingdom in all the world, the jewel of the Aegean, glittering Ilium, the city that rose and fell not once but twice. Gatekeeper of traffic in and out of the barbarous East, kingdom of gold and horses, fierce nurse of prophets, princes, heroes, warriors, and poets. Under the protection of Ares, Artemis, Apollo, and Aphrodite, she stood for years as the paragon of all that can be achieved in the arts of war and peace, trade and treaty, love and art, statecraft, piety, and civil harmony. When she fell, a hole opened in the human world that may never be filled, save in memory. Poets must sing the story over and over again, passing it from generation to generation, lest in losing Troy, we lose a part of ourselves. To understand Troy's end, we must understand her beginning. The background to our story has many twists and turns. A host of place names, personalities, and families enter and exit. It's not necessary to remember every name, every relationship of blood and marriage, every kingdom and province. The story emerges, and the important names will, I promise, stick. All things, Troy included, begin and end with Zeus, the king of the gods, ruler of Olympus, lord of thunder, cloud gatherer, and bringer of storms. Long, long ago, almost before the dawn of mortal history, Zeus consorted with Electra, a beautiful daughter of the Titan Atlas and the sea nymph Pleione. Electra bore Zeus a son, Dardanus, who travelled throughout Greece and the islands of the Aegean, searching for a place in which he could build and raise his own dynasty. He alighted at last on the Ionian coast. If you have never visited Ionia, you should know that it's the land east of the Aegean Sea, which used to be called Asia Minor, but which we know as Turkish Anatolia. The great kingdoms of Phrygia and Lydia were there, but they were already occupied and ruled over, so it was in the north that Dardanus settled, occupying the peninsula that lies below the Hellespont, the straits into which Helle fell from the back of the golden ram. Years later, Jason would sail through the Hellespont on his way to find the fleece of that ram. The love-struck Leander would swim nightly across the Hellespont to be with Hero, his beloved. The stories of Helle, the golden ram, and Jason can be found in Heroes and the tragedy of Hero and Leander in Mythos. Even later in history, those same straits, now called the Dardanelles after Dardanus, were the source of terrible fighting in and around the peninsula city that the Greeks called Kallipolis, beautiful city, which over time had turned into the name Gallipoli. The city Dardanus established was called, with little imagination and less modesty, Dardanus, while the whole kingdom took on the name Dardania. Following the founder king's death, Ilus, the eldest of his three sons, ruled, but he died childless, leaving the throne to his brother, the middle son, Erichthonius. The reign of Erichthonius was peaceful and prosperous. In the lee of Mount Ida, his lands were fed by the waters of the benign river gods Simeis and Scamander, who blessed the land of Dardania with great fertility. Erichthonius grew to become the richest man in the known world, famous for his 3,000 mares and their countless foals. Boreas, the north wind, took the form of a wild stallion and fathered a remarkable race of horses by the filly foals of Erichthonius's herd. These colts were so agile and light of foot, they could gallop through fields of corn without bending a stalk. So they say. Horses and riches. Always, when we talk of Troy, we find ourselves talking of wondrous horses and uncountable riches. Foundation. After the death of Erichthonius, his son, Tros, succeeded to the throne. Tros had a daughter, Cleopatra, and three sons, Ilus, named in honour of his great-uncle, Assaracus, and Ganymede. The story of Prince Ganymede is well known. His beauty was so great that Zeus himself was seized by an overmastering passion for him. Taking the form of an eagle, the god swooped down and bore the boy up to Olympus, where he served as Zeus's beloved minion, companion, and cupbearer. To compensate Tros for the loss of his son, Zeus sent Hermes to him, bearing the gift of two divine horses, so swift and light they could gallop over water. Tros was consoled by these magical animals and by Hermes' assurance that Ganymede was now, and by definition, always would be, immortal. Indeed, the cupbearer lives two immortal lives in the night sky, as the constellation Aquarius, the water carrier, and as a moon of his lover, Jupiter. The planets all take on the gods' Roman names. It was Ganymede's brother, Prince Ilus, who founded the new city that would be named Troy in Tros's honour. He won a wrestling match at the Phrygian Games, the prize consisting of 50 youths and 50 maidens, but, more importantly, a cow. A very special cow that an oracle directed Ilus to use for the founding of a city. Wherever the cow lies down, there shall you build. If Ilus had heard the story of Cadmus, and who had not, he would have known that Cadmus and Harmonia, acting in accordance with instructions from an oracle, had followed a cow and waited for the animal to lie down as an indication of where they were to build what would become Thebes, the first of the great city-states of Greece. It may seem to us that the practice of allowing cows to choose where a city should be built is arbitrary and bizarre, but perhaps a little reflection should tell us that it is not so strange after all. Where there is to be a city, there must also be plentiful sources of meat, milk, leather, and cheese for its citizens, not to mention strong draft animals, oxen for ploughing fields and pulling carts. If a cow is taken enough by the amenities of a region to feel able to lie down, then it is worth paying attention. At any rate, Ilus was content to follow his prize heifer all the way north from Phrygia to the Troad. Also in honour of Tros, the whole peninsula was beginning now to be referred to as the Troad, past the slopes of Mount Ida and onto the great plain of Dardania, and it was here, not far from where Ilus's great-grandfather's first city of Dardanus had been built, that the heifer lay down at last. Ilus looked about him. It was a fine place for a new city. To the south rose the massif of Mount Ida, and at some distance to the north ran the straits of the Hellespont. To the east, the blue of the Aegean could be glimpsed, and through the green and fertile plain itself threaded the rivers Simois and Scamander. Ilus knelt down and prayed to the gods for a sign that he had made no mistake. In immediate answer, a wooden object fell from the sky and landed at his feet in a great cloud of dust. It was about the height of a 10-year-old child and carved into a likeness of Pallas Athena, a spear in one upraised hand and a distaff and spindle in the other, representing the arts of war and the arts of peace, over which the grey-eyed goddess held dominion. The act of looking at so sacred an object struck Ilus instantly blind. He was wise enough in the ways of the Olympians not to panic. Falling to his knees, he cast up prayers of thanks to the heavens. After a week of steadfast devotion, he was rewarded with the restoration of his sight. Brimming with revived energy and zeal, he began at once to lay out the foundations for his new city. He planned the streets so that they radiated like the spokes of a wheel from a central temple which he would dedicate to Athena. In the innermost sanctum of the temple, he placed the wooden carving of Pallas Athena that fell from the sky.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.